All right, let's get started. It's my pleasure to introduce Tom Anderson, who's here as part of our distinguished lecture series. So Tom does not need any introduction if you work on any systems area, operating systems, distributed systems, network, security. I'm sure you know Tom and you've read his papers. But he's a professor at the University of Washington, and he's won many awards, and that's why I actually have this piece of paper. There's no way I could memorize
it's
all
like
of
James
them.
Kirk.
Yeah. Yeah, sure. He's a member of the NAE, National Academy of Engineering, American Academy of Arts and Sciences. He's the winner of USENIX Lifetime Achievement Award, the USENIX Thug Award, the IEEE Koji Kobayashi Computer and Communications Award, the ACMC SmartWiser Award, and also the IEEE Communication Society William Holden Prize. He's the ACM Fellow. If you look at Tom's record, he has many, many great papers and has won many best papers in top systems conferences such as SOSP, OSPI, ASPLUS, MSDI. So it's a great honor to have him here. And also, one last thing, he has a great book on operating system, a textbook on operating system. I actually used that in my grad operating system course. Anyways, I'm teaching it this quarter. And it's really cool that I could tell my students that, by the way, this is a book that we're going to use. And by the way, Tom is going to come and give a talk to make sure we this talk. And I see my students from my class here, too. All right, so with that being said, please join me in welcoming Tom.
Here. So okay, so I'm a bit of a call to maybe to speak up mic a little bit so I don't have to shout. But let's see if I can get started here. Okay, so this work I should say that I'm gonna talk about one of the things about being a faculty member, all the faculty member here will understand, is that almost all actual work gets done by students or colleagues and I've been really great, actually, working with a set of people on the things I'm going to talk about here. Arlan mentioned the textbook, actually. This entire research direction came out of the effort of having to write the textbook. I had done operating systems, taught operating systems for a long time, but then had done research in other areas not really come back to it. But writing the textbook, I realized there were many things about operating systems that I didn't understand. And one of them was I.O. I was like, okay, I.O. is this incredibly boring area of operating systems. Just it's like there's nothing interesting at all in I.O. Like generally dominated by these devices that have like all these complex interfaces, difficult to program. Pretty much everybody tried to avoid it as much as possible. But there had been quite a lot of innovation in essentially the device to operating system interface for I.O., and that it, even with that innovation, it was becoming more and more of a problem. And so a lot of the motivation for the work was trying to understand how operating system servers and data centers needed to interact with I.O. For different things. I should say, Emma and Simon are at Texas. This isn't just Mathi, it's a PhD. Zurich, what I find is actually it's now possible that Google to collaborate with people in all sorts of different places, like to go visit places in part to kind of start collaborations. So where did this start? So we run in data centers workloads, not solely workloads that are I/O dependent, but like a large number of workloads that are really important for data center operations are I/O. IO capacity limited. So examples of these would be like just straightforward key value store, any kind of web or file server or database, machine learning. Generally, the kind of operation here is going to be small RPCs. You're going to send a message to a node, it does a small amount of computation and then replies back. Now, one of the questions you have for this is the systems that we're currently using for these delivering close to the performance of what the underlying hardware is? And I'm going to actually use this as an example, actually. This is a slide from 5 years ago. So this is what a computer would look like 5 years ago. And even at that point, the performance really had certain problems with it. So let's say we have a 10 gig link. We're not there today, but what that means is you're delivering a 1,000 kilobyte packet in 2 microseconds. If you had a flash, I think I might have lost the performance number for that. Oh yeah, there it is. Performance number for that is flash actually has been decreasing over time, essentially for what its write performance would be. That is decreasing the latency of writes, so that you can now, you can think that we used to have spinning disks that would take milliseconds, now we can do writes in 20s or 20s of microseconds, and then we'd have some number of cores that's increasing over time. So one of the things you might think is I/O devices are slow, but actually they're fast and getting faster. And that's not today's, that's actually yesterday's I/O devices were fast and getting faster. Here's like today's I/O devices. So 40 gig NICs are common, 100 gig NICs are like, you can buy them and definitely getting deployed. So that means that you're delivering a 1,000 byte packet in a couple hundred nanoseconds. So it's taking latency of maybe 10 microseconds to get across the data center, but you're getting another 1,000 byte packet every couple hundred nanoseconds. And if you have a small packet, like a single key value lookup where the lookup and the key and the outcome of the key value is small, that could be something you're delivering those in a few tens of microseconds. You need to be able to handle those at the tens of microseconds. And then non-volatile RAM, another technology that people are putting in place for various reasons. Their write latencies are even an order of magnitude better than the flash devices that we had just 5 years ago. And then those were orders of magnitude better than the disk devices we were using. So the performance of these I/O devices are getting much, much better over time. So one question you could have is, okay, Linux will solve all these problems. We work in this area. We'll just let Linux developers deal with this. Now, if you then go and measure the performance of Linux on these devices, and this is for the devices we had 5 years ago, even something simple like a Redis lookup is spending almost all its time in the kernel. So this is, a Redis is a key, persistent key value store in widespread use in practice. A normal get operation, which doesn't actually have to hit the disk, it's just in memory, is going to spend, you know, 2/3 of its time, and this is on a 10 gigabit link, you know, so on today's system even worse. So 9 seconds. And also, this is using UDP, so it's even kind of an optimistic case for the cost of doing these things. For sets, you should actually have to go through the file system and do the right-hand logging and all the other operations. Just enormous amounts of time being spent in the kernel, and almost very little of the amount of this is actually going to what the application is going to do. So those are, you know, for the devices we have. So what's the reason for that? Well, part of the reason for that is that you're doing a lot of work in the kernel. So you need the API, you have some set of, you know, naming and access control, I/O processing protection, multiplexing, various things that the operating system has to do in order to make the abstraction of those devices visible to an application in a way that's safe and secure. What the argument that we're going to make, and it's not, by this point, kind of controversial one, is that the kernel mediation is going to be too heavyweight for these systems going forward. And so the project which we started was to try to say, how do you figure out how to optimize the data plane, that is the path by which you're getting the data from I/O into the application and then back again in a kind of optimized way. And yet, still having the same properties that we had in systems that we want, that is, we still want the same security model, we still want process isolation, we still want the things that the operating system is providing for us, but we don't want to pay that penalty on the data. So trying to figure out how to do this and kind of separate the roles of an operating system into what it's saying about how the information is supposed to flow through the system, and then a separate question of how well we can manage the data flow through the system. And this is actually something that the kind of networking community had to struggle with and has, I think, succeeded at. If you look inside of network switches or network routers, they tend to actually think of this in this kind of dual mode, which is, okay, the algorithms we deal with trying to figure out how to configure a system, and then there's this how do we have efficient data plane operation. Kind of it, harking back a step, it really feels very much similar to the kind of transition that the community took back in the 60s when we shifted to doing virtual memory hardware. So it had been the case that we want process isolation. In order to get that, it's really wildly too efficient to do it. If we're going to try to do it in software, so instead what we're going to do is to have this hardware support for it. But the operating system does is to configure the hardware to do what we want, and then the hardware operates just on its own directly. So what that would look like for us would be say, okay, if we want to have I/O going directly to applications, then you would look at all the different elements of what the kernel does and say, okay, where should these different pieces of functionality go in the future? You could kind of say, okay, what about what can we move down into the device itself? Well, you know, potentially it means that we need to put protection. So an example would be put virtualization hardware so that, for example, the I/O device could talk to application code directly in a with virtual addresses and would have some understanding of how to do multiplexing or scheduling properties. These would normally be things that the operating system would do for itself. But that if you're going to actually go through the kernel, then the consequence of that's going to be slowing things down to an inappropriate amount. And then you could potentially have the configuring of those things be something that the kernel is still doing. So what else can we get rid of? Potentially we can move some of the aspects of how, for example, how sockets work for talking with the I/O devices. We could actually do that at user level. There's nothing privileged about how sockets work. And then some amount of I/O processing that we could do up there. Some things that we would have the kernel do possibly we can get rid of. So for example, copying, like maybe if the I/O device delivers the information directly to the application, we don't need to be copying anymore, just drop those off. And then the rest, right, you can think, okay, there are things that the kernel needs to do for access, you know, access control or resource limits or naming, the things that it's actually configuring for trying to give its security properties to that are still essential, but that we don't want to actually end up doing the data plane. So let's move those out of the way and kind of reconfigure. And then you end up with something that says, okay, we have this world where applications on I/O devices talk directly, and the kernel ends up operating off to the side. In this type of architecture now, one of the challenges becomes, oh, okay, now what should this work end up, you know, what work do I want to put in the I/O device? What work do I want to put here? What are the interfaces for the rest of the system? So kind of just capping off kind of summary of this kind of line of work that I'm going to end up giving you some concrete examples for in the rest of the talk. So streamlining network and storage I/O by eliminating OS mediation, keeping the functionality of the operating system so it still provides processing in interaction, it still arbitrates access to the shared resources, it still enforces all of those things that you want the operating system to provide, and it's still application compatible. So from the application side, it'll look like it's still POSIX, although that POSIX is now implemented in a library rather than implemented as an operating system kernel system call abstraction. And that this is going to require some amount of hardware help. So one question that you would have about this is, okay, what could we reasonably expect the hardware to be doing over time? And if we can anticipate what hardware capabilities will be, then potentially we can say, okay, this would be a reasonable design at least one. I think probably you'll think what you'll end up with is, oh, is that hardware actually reasonable, or is that feasible for us to do? I'm going to give what's essentially a hardware design talk here, even though I'm an operating system person and really haven't done very much hardware design at all. Okay, is that a reasonable amount of hardware to expect? And I think what I'm going to argue over the next couple slides is kind of take a digression and try to argue what is a reasonable amount of hardware to expect computer systems to have in terms of support for doing common case operations. And so where is hardware going? And I'm going to give this in a kind of widely divergent reason that you can think, oh, that's nothing related to what we're currently doing. And I think in many ways what I really like about computer science is this ability to draw from understanding other areas of computer science and trying to pull ideas from different places and kind of trying to figure out what the logic of the market is working as a consequence of it. So my example is going to be Bitcoin, which probably a bunch of you know quite a lot about, and I'm not going to actually try to explain Bitcoin to you. But it has a lot of really interesting outcomes. The kind of Bitcoin ecosystem has a lot of really interesting illustrations for what the future of computer science is going to look like. So Bitcoin is, kind of technically, it's a protocol for Byzantine fault-tolerant ledgers. So what I mean by that is that a Byzantine fault-tolerant would say that the participants in the system don't have to be trustworthy. Now most fault-tolerant systems you're using in a data center are going to be trustworthy. That is, you're assuming that the servers are operating in an appropriate way, that haven't been owned or that have been taken over by an attacker. The protocols to be able to do Byzantine fault-tolerance in kind of distributed system setting tend to be really expensive. And Bitcoin's no exception. It's a really expensive protocol for doing Byzantine fault-tolerance. It's a public ledger in the sense that its design is essentially to try to have essentially a banking system that's independent of any individual bank. So your bank balances are actually public. They're cryptographically signed. You can transfer money between bank accounts without any needing to go through any central authority. That it's essentially a community working together. So cryptographically signed ledger. A sequence of transfers. But those transfers could actually be anything. It happens to be digital currency now, but like currently in the future, could be, you know, contract, could be anything. Okay, so the important thing for the part that I'm about to talk about is that it provides an incentive for this Byzantine fault tolerance system to work by essentially giving reward, as e-currency reward, to nodes that participate in the system to essentially validate this Byzantine fault tolerance system. So the proof of work ends up being a solve of a cryptographic puzzle, so a certain number, solving a certain number of bits of a SHA-256 hash. So you would have some large hash function, and what you were trying to do is to solve that find, for example, a particular hash that matched on the first 70 bits or 80 bits of the hash function. And that would be something that you could only do if the cryptographic hash is accurate, would be something you would have to actually try by brute force. And so you're having to simply do a whole large number of guesses to try to find one of these. Now, it's relatively difficult to spoof. That is, okay, the proof of work, you actually have to do all the work for it. If you solve that cryptographic puzzle, then you both get a reward and you move the protocol forward in terms of where its ledger is. And because you actually have to do the work to guess, it's not something that somebody can make up, it becomes Byzantine fault tolerant because it means that the people who are doing the work will actually decide what operations get done and what ones don't. And if you want your work to happen and not someone else's, then you have to actually do the work for it. Now, I should say there are aspects of Bitcoin that are quite difficult or bad, right? So one of them is that Bitcoin actually only operates at a rate of a few transactions a second. And its energy cost is roughly the same as Ireland. So, you know, as you're thinking, okay, that's not a particularly efficient Byzantine fault-tolerant protocol, that's true. I'm not gonna try to argue that it is. What's important here is that there was an incentive for people to build faster cryptographic solvers. And what you see out of the history of this is essentially this climbing of people who said, okay, we'll start when Bitcoin started back in 2009, and people were just, oh, okay, I'll just solve the puzzles, essentially. Puzzles get created on a periodic basis, throw some amount of money. I forget now exactly how much the reward is, but at least the last time I checked, which is like a year ago, it's probably more now, was around $10,000 for every 10 minutes or so for doing one of these cryptographic puzzles. And you know, that kind of actually adds up over time, so people have an incentive to try to do these operations more efficiently. And you're thinking, oh, okay, so there's now a market for doing computation, a market for solving it in a more efficient fashion. And so over time, what you saw was, okay, first the solvers were CPU bound, where basically people would say, oh, I could just use my desktop to just make some money off of the spare cycles. I'm not running games on my system. And then people are like, okay, but you know, that's only so good. I could use the GPU in my system and make it go faster. So they essentially assemble a bunch of GPUs that like lasts for about a year. Then somebody come along and say, okay, this GPU is way too slow. It's inefficient. Let me go and started using FPGAs for it, and that lasted for some, that lasted for a little while, so essentially FPGA-based system. So on this side, it's essentially a exponential curve of how many hashes you're doing per, I think per second, I think. I'm not 100% sure what the units on this side are. Essentially exponential of how many solvings we're having to do in order to solve the issue. At this point, then, people started doing VLSI. It's like, okay, well, I can beat an FPGA system if I put it into silicon. I can beat a GPU by putting in an FPGA. I can beat a CPU by putting in a GPU. And then, okay, let's start on kind of low-end nanometer technology, so low-end VLSI. And then pretty quickly, like, lights just, you know, increase the density, kind of use higher and higher integration, kind of closer to the leading edge of what Intel would do for a modern processor. And now, generally, these systems are now built out of the kind of best and most recent fab technologies for VLSI. Okay, so the consequence of that new thing is essentially that we've driven, this example is driven through all of the different possible technologies we might be able to assemble for it. Now, I think one of the interesting things about this is, so one of the interesting things is just how cheap it is for somebody to crack a SHA-256 hash. So that's the market price of doing a petahash of solutions for a SHA is about a penny. And you should think of this as roughly if you have a password of however many bits, that it's a penny for somebody to run a password hacker check on it for up to 50 bits of randomness in your password. And now normal humans will only have about 20 bits of randomness in their password. So essentially, what this has shown is if you have enough money, which say a reasonable size government has enough money, we'll be able to crack any password file that they ever require on any website that might be able to hack into. So as a consequence, like, do we actually, or passwords are reasonable outcome games. But I think the second part is just to recognize that if there is an efficiency in these systems to be had, and if there's money to be made for building more efficient systems, you're going to just push up this line towards where we start with running things in CPUs, and we start running them in GPUs, and then we're going to run them in FGAs, and then we're going to run them on VLSI. And that mechanism is just going to be inexorable for data centers going in the future. We might think of ourselves as software engineers, but in the future we're going to be hardware designers. Because what we're going to need to do is to take all the things that we do all the time and make them efficient. So one of the interesting things about how Bitcoin has played out over time, I think this is the next slide or the next slide after that, is that the benefit, that is the daily revenue per, I think this is gigahashes per second, dropped over time. Essentially, as we started getting better at these things and say, okay, well, I could build this miner out of FPGA, and it essentially drives everybody else out of the system. And it drives everybody out of the system because it's energy inefficient. So you might think, oh, okay, Bitcoin is the least energy efficient mechanism I could think of to do a Byzantine fault tolerant system out of. But if I wanted to get mining to be efficient, if I want to compute hashes, then only the most energy efficient solutions end up being possible. And that you actually can't run a miner, even if you had one that was based on FPGAs, you wouldn't be able to afford to run it. You would lose money off the energy that the FPGA would run in order to do the computation. And essentially, like, about half of the price that you're getting out of Bitcoin is actually the energy cost that went into the mining of Bitcoin. So as Bitcoin goes up, the amount of energy it uses kind of scales with it, because basically the more miners will start in, because it's a free market, they'll use more energy. It's essentially this direct, if you want Bitcoin to use less energy, the only solution for that would be to cause them to be less valuable. Right? If Bitcoin was banned, for example, then there would be less energy used for it. But the other side is that our data centers will be driven by whatever technology is going to be most energy efficient, and there won't be room essentially for people to be doing things that are inefficient. And so where this goes from the kind of operating system side is you can look at how we're going through these data path operations, which we're doing, you know, trillions of times per second in every major data center, which is we're taking packets in through a network interface, through the Linux kernel, through socket buffers, through a set of things in the TCP stack, and then delivering them up to an application, and then turning right around and saying, okay, that was a key value lookup, great, here's the key, and or here's the value, great, here's the answer. Where the application code is tiny and the amount of overhead we're applied for it is large, that will just be driven out just because it will have to be driven out because there's actual money, real money at stake. And a modern amount of money being spent per year on data centers worldwide is, I think, roughly about $100 billion a year. So even a 1% performance benefit on a kind of data center scale, it's an enormous amount of money that would be worth doing any amount of hardware design. And in fact, actually, if you look at the cloud, the cloud operators, they all have hardware development in the direction of making more efficient systems for doing I/O. So from the kind of academic side, it turned out to be pretty important. Okay, so I've talked pretty much about the Arrakis kind of overview and kind of how to think about it from the OS perspective. I'm going to dive down and do a bit more on how to think about network interfaces. There's another way that you can think of from the file system perspective. So how do you build storage devices that are low energy, and essentially non-volatile memory systems like IBM, Intel Crosspoint, are also in the direction towards trying to build really large scale systems that are very energy efficient. And they also have really interesting things to say about file system design. If I have time, I'll get to it. But I've been told anyway that one of the students I've been working with had come and gave a job talk on this, so it's probably less important for me to cover. But just realize that those things actually tie together. So maybe the first step that you would think of is, okay, suppose we wanted to build a fast server. It's supposed to run these kind of applications that are doing key value store, databases, kind of servers, machine learning. What are they mostly doing? They're mostly doing small RPCs over TCP. They're mostly operating on really fast links. You know, 100 gigabits are coming soon. I should say 100 gigabits is not where they're going to end. These network links are scaling at a pretty rapid rate. So there's definitely prototypes of 400 gigabit links in the lab. So they're not going to just stop there. It's going to keep going up. We still want there to be a forcible resource sharing. That is, the operating system behavior that you want out of the system still needs to be something that will be able to enable users to share things. We want there to be agile program development. Even though these things are going to get embedded into hardware, we still want it to be the case that we can configure them efficiently as we figure out better algorithms. So we need to figure out how to make the kernel and the application and the operating system all agile. We need to worry about tail latency, and we need to worry about other things. Anyway, other aspects of this as we go along. Okay, so there's a set of considerations we need to have for this. But if you look at where the time is going in, say, an RPC over Linux TCP, I had said in the previous one that was for UDPs over a 10 gigabit length. This is RPCs over Linux TCP over 40 gig length. And you know, suppose what your application is doing is something really, really, you know, normal, like, you know, runs a few hundred cycles of computation on every RPC call. You know, returns say a few hundred bytes of an RPC. This is not an unreasonable thing for a normal either a machine learning application that's doing a parameter server or a normal application that's doing key value store. You know, the amount of computation you're doing per operation that you're doing in and out is going to be relatively small. You could be spending, you know, just an enormous amount of time that you're spending just running overhead. You might think that the solution for this is to use a lighter weight protocol. It's like, oh, okay, it's what's really going on here is TCP is the problem. One, the overheads are pretty high even if you're doing UDP, but even beyond that, you need to have some layer of the support that TCP provides. Even if you're not using TCP itself, you want to have something that looks a lot like TCP. So if you're doing an RPC, so a remote procedure call to a remote node, you want it to be the case. You want the programming abstraction to be able to say, hey, I have this data structure I want to send over there. And the data structure might usually will be inside of a packet. That's the problem. sometimes it'll be bigger than a packet. So I'll need to split it up into multiple packets. So now I have to have some kind of fragmentation or segmentation that needs to work. I need some kind of flow control so I'm not overrunning the buffers on the other side. I need some kind of congestion control mechanism so I'm not overrunning the buffers in the middle of the network. I need some way to do loss recovery. So what if packets get lost in the network? How do I do recovery for it? I need some kind of buffer management. So all of the, all of those things add overhead. I have to figure out how to do all those operations. They all look like they have to be done, and they all look like they have to be done in the data path. Right? So one of the questions here is like, okay, do we really need all these things? How do we do them in an efficient fashion? So it's not just a matter of, oh, okay, you could just change a protocol and you're done. It's like you actually need these properties out of the system. Small RPCs dominate. You might think that one of the things that you might do, so the first thing that's got to observe is that if you're spending this amount of time, like you kernel mediation is just going to be not good enough. So we need to be able to somehow get from our next directly the application. Hopefully I convinced you of that by now. And fortunately, there are hardware devices that get you in this direction. They're called SRIOP. They're now pretty widespread use, at least in limited properties. So essentially the idea is to take a hardware support that will take the device, whatever network device you have, or even this will work for other devices, and then make a virtualized version of it that the application can directly use. And so the simple version of this would be you take a network interface card, so an NIC interface card, and then you simply virtualize it. So that you could then map that into user space. So the user program then looks like it's actually using this network interface card directly. It has its own registers, queues, it has its own, looks like you have to write a device driver inside of the application, but okay, you get direct access to it. So what's its protection model? It's gonna say, essentially allow you to allow the device to have access to application virtual memory. And then the packet filters essentially would say, if a packet, for example, would arrive for a particular connection, then the device would say, oh, okay, this is actually meant for this virtual NIC and not for this other virtual NIC, so I'll send it to that. If you do that, and you say, okay, let's ignore all the features that we would have out of the kernel, like what would this give you in terms of kind of performance methodology that you need before? If you ignore all the functionality the kernel was providing, which are things like enforcement of resource allocation in the network itself, then you get an improvement roughly 2 to 3 and moving it to user level, skipping the Linux kernel on time, implementing it around version of this. There was a system called MTCP that got published a few years ago out of Case that tried to do this. But you can understand that actually this system didn't actually get used, even though it gave this performance benefit, it didn't actually get used in practice in most data centers. And part of the reason for it is that actually congestion, there are things that the kernel has to do that are kind of non-negotiable. And an example is you don't want the application to be able to send an arbitrary speed on any particular connection. You need to be able to enforce that it's going to be responsive to congestion signals. Otherwise, it's the case that one application could completely overrun some parts of your network and cause packet losses for other completely unrelated connections. So there's some layer of interface that we have to provide. Either the hardware has to provide it or some combination of what the operating system can provide. So there's some steps that you would have to say, okay, if you don't provide congestion control, sorry, I can't use this. So we need something to have enforceable resource sharing as well. We want no kernel mediation, but somebody's got to do this enforceable resource scheduling. It's not just a matter of saying, hey, this container can only send at a certain rate. Often these systems are doing N-way communication with N other systems, so I can't just say, hey, just don't send too fast in aggregate. It might be the case that this particular electrode right here is what's congested because there was a failure, it has lower capacity than some other part. I need to say that this particular connection is something that you're limited by. And you need to keep information about that that's coming back from the network and do that in an efficient way. That's actually what the kernel is doing for you in a normal system. So a bunch of people would say, okay, really, there's this you know, hardware solution we have. You've been arguing for hardware. Why not do remote DMA? So RDMA is a really popular system. You've heard of it. But basically, the programming model actually dates from the 80s, which is essentially to say, I'll give you an interface that will be really simple to the application program, not sockets, but rather I can do a remote operation to remote memory. So like I write to remote memory, I can read from remote memory. Looked like a DMA operation, so I just block copy memory from one place to another. DMA in the sense that it's not cache, generally not cache, there's a cache current on the other side, but it's not necessarily atomic. It's not an atomic read or whatever. So what would that allow you to do? It would mean that you could have data structures that you could go talk about on some far node and then go read or poke or modify. And you would need to have some kind of synchronization in addition to this, so usually the hardware support for it also involves actually some message passing as well. It got widely adopted by the high-performance computing community for building racks of computers. There's this thing called InfiniBand. It was based on an idea that the packet, there was no packet loss in the system because it was relatively small scale, which then it extended to the data center. Unfortunately, in a data center setting, actually packet loss is kind of inherent. And so the kind of protocols for that are somewhat problematic, actually. It's really difficult to get these RDMA systems to kind of interact effectively with other systems. So that actually ends up not necessarily fundamental with others. And it doesn't really answer this question, what if I wanted to actually, instead of having just this really simple model, what if I wanted to have useful communication that was going on the other side, not just a read or a write, but what if I wanted actual application code to run on the other side? How do I get that to work effectively? It doesn't really answer that question at all. So some of the people have been working on this, oh, well, maybe I can actually run that code in the network, in the RDMA device itself. Well, maybe that's a small processor. So what I think you want is this notion of having agile protocols, that is the ability to add extra stuff to it. Oh, if I want to change the congestion control protocol, I don't want to have this be a lossless protocol, I want to have a loss recovery mechanism in it. Or I want, maybe the RDMA model is okay for an application, but I want to be able to combine it with a set of other things that would also work. So how do I get those things to work? So in addition, I potentially want other things. So you might think, okay, if RDMA isn't it, maybe yes, there are these things that you can buy that are called smart NICs. So you can have essentially a network interface card with an array of processors on it. So Cavium vendors will have versions of this where they basically put processors on the network interface card. And if you can compute on the NIC, then you don't need to go to the CPU. And then there are actually a bunch of applications for this in high-speed trading, but for general purpose, computing needs to be less clear. We have actually been here before, like we had done IO work in the past, like 20 years ago. There was actually this actual phrase for this particular design choice, which is to take some bit of computation and say, oh, okay, we could do it on the network interface. It'll be so much better if we do it on the network interface. It's called the wheel of reinvention, because the idea is you would move into the network interface, and then, of course, the network interface would lag the processor speeds, because the processors would keep getting faster and faster over time, and maybe the network interface didn't. And so then you would say, hey, maybe we can move this from the slow network interface card back to the processor, and then, you know, okay, that'll make everything fast again. And then you say, oh, okay, but then we can build a faster network interface card. So you kind of move this back and forth. Main CPUs tend to be faster, deeper cores. There are cases where you actually want to run the computation on the core. I don't think it necessarily solves the problem. And then you also have the problem with multi-tenant issues. So like, how is it you split an application code onto these cores in a different way, or is it just only something that only one can use? Okay, so you want cost efficient or multi-tenant use for the application. Okay, so one question, so like, okay, let's start again and ask, okay, why was it that Linux was so slow? Instead of thinking, okay, there's some hardware solution for it correctly, maybe we can try to understand what caused Linux to be so slow and maybe try to work our way forward from that. So one thing that you probably don't know about these kind of I/O architectures is that there's been a huge amount of innovation between the network hardware and the kernel. And so these systems for actually delivering the network packet into the kernel are actually extremely fast. They're extremely optimized. They use hardware queues, transmit and receive queues that are designed for parallelism. Often per core for them, so that I can actually, you know, they actually know contention for cache coherence, so there won't be any contention for locks. There is no interrupt in the common case. Like, you probably learned how I/O worked when you were in school, and you thought, oh, okay, what do you do when you get an I/O, when you get a device that wants attention from the operating system is it sets an interrupt. There's almost in no case will there actually be an interrupt delivered in the common case, because it's essentially just streaming in and out. Like, if I'm supposed to handle a packet every couple hundred nanoseconds, I'm not taking an interrupt, right? Because the interrupt handler is just going to take a couple hundred nanoseconds itself. So I'm going to need to stream this in at a high rate. It just gets put into a buffer, and then a bit is set in using the DMA, and then the other side is the operating system is sitting on a colon loop pulling the data out and then moving it on. So that's great. You know, if we could just have this, but instead of this being the operating system, make it like the application code and still have all the functionality we need out of the operating system, we'd all be done. So we want kind of that model, but not like that model. Okay, so when we actually get into the operating system, then you've got a whole lot of other stuff going on. So you've got to have a socket layer, there's congestion flow control, all these things are kind of essential. We have to copy some data, we have to arm the retransmission, there's an IP layer that's doing a set of other policy issues. The driver's moving the keys around, there's allocation and buffering. Even like the interfaces themselves are pretty expensive. So for example, for actually just getting the data from the application out of the kernel, there's usually two calls involved, which is like, oh, first, is there information on a socket for me to get? And then I can go and actually read it. So that requires more transitions between them. So what we decided to do is try to build this system called TCP as a service. And the idea is essentially to build a user level, it's kind of the optimal thing, so like a user level engine that operates as a trusted OS service that uses this SRIV, essentially for direct delivery to application code, this running essentially as a trusted OS service, to as many ports as needed in order to execute the execution. So remember that you're spending 90% of your time or 97% of your time doing the execution of the TCP code and the kernel in some cases. It means that all of your processors are getting used to this anyway, so you might as well just dedicate some ports to it and try to scale them up that way. And then it uses essentially the hardware design, that is these skips, circular buffers and direct delivery, into this, this TCP as a service and then off to the application code. I think that I missed putting on a slide to make that work. Anyway, so then, and then the next step, like that would only just, oh, okay, then it's just slow code writing at user level. Then take the effort of trying to say, how could you streamline this as much as possible? So what code could you get rid of? What code could you streamline as much as you could? So an example would be that generally the Linux code will have state, that is, I mean to say, data structures, for keeping track of the information about what's happening with a particular connection. It's spread over multiple data structures. And it's like, okay, well, what you really should do if you wanted to make this fast would be to put all the data in one data structure. That's like essentially reorganizing the kernel would be more efficient. So another one would be, oh, okay, every packet that gets sent gets a timeout set for it because you need to do retransmission. Well, that's in the data path saying, hey, you're going to add extra work as a consequence of handling this packet. Possibly you could say instead, because almost all packets are delivered, that the common case behavior should be to check for packet loss in some out-of-band fashion. Another case you could say that your allocation and deallocation of buffers for data that's coming in out of the kernel or out of the system should be kind of automatic. They should be a circular buffer model of the world rather than something that actually requires actual explicit allocation and deallocation. So, like, again, taking kind of all of those and putting them together. Another one is that, like, oh, okay, do you really need an IP layer? You do, because you need that there be this kind of control issue, like, oh, is the application even allowed to send this type of packet? But you'd like to actually enforce that in the control plane, essentially not allow people to establish a connection if they don't have the permission to do so, essentially not even giving them the opportunity to send packets of a particular type. So if you do all of that, then you end up with something that looks as essentially, this is the orange line here is the TCP as a service. So almost as fast as this system that just completely ignores all of the features that the operating system provides and just does use the level of MTCP that I was talking about earlier. And so this is out on 16 processors, so roughly a factor of three faster than Linux. And actually, we believe that we can get our more recent data is something like a factor of four. So you can think of it essentially, it's user-level TCP, but now we're enforcing congestion control on the system. And that you haven't actually lost anything by actually transitioning this thing through a user-level service. But that's only a factor of three. Like, that gets you, actually, if you go back to the slide, that actually only gets you to the point where the application, whereas before we were spending like 90% of our time on the CPU running the TCP layer, now we're running about half of the time we're spending running TCP and half the time we're running the application code. So ultimately, you're going to get to where you say, okay, that's a whole lot of work, and maybe we can move a whole lot of that TCP as a service into hardware. Like, to kind of say where we're heading here. But if RPCs are the common case, then you need to do this kernel bypass, but you want to implement as much of the data plane and hardware. And the only thing that gets left in the kernel should be policy control. You want it to be protocol agnostic, because the protocols are changed, but then also on some efficient hardware. So the model of hardware we're designing for is this thing called reconfigurable match action tables, where the idea is that packet arrives, and in hardware, you're then parsing it into some configurable set of instances. So you think, okay, it was an Ethernet packet, but really underneath the covers was also IPv4, or TCP, UDP, and then it's RPC header on top of that. And then based on that, then you're going to pass it through something that's got some number of stages where you're doing some amount of TKM lookup, SRAM, and some registers to then figure out what to do with it. So looking against wildcard matches against packet headers and so forth to be able to say, okay, this is what we want to transform the packet to do. I'll give you an example of what you can do with this in a second. But then run through this through a set of things that then decides what to do with it. You can think, for example, that if I wanted to take an arriving packet and try to direct it to the flow that needed to read it, like just a queue directly in hardware to the queue that actually needs it to come, then what I need to do is to look at the packet header, say, okay, this is a packet heading for this particular connection ID, and I know as a result of some state I have reserved for it that this is where it's supposed to go. But we'd like to be able to implement as much as possible of the data flow operation of TCP and this hardware. So one of the questions is, will we be able to do that? So one aspect is the outcome of this would be, okay, where are you actually going in this? And then the other is that kind of you do this match side, and then the action could be to set a counter or do some other bit of operation. Now, you might ask, oh, okay, that looks all pretty complicated, but actually, it's, the switch layer, you could build, the people that build these systems to run at multiple terabits, the kind of commercial products. Usually, those are with parallel streams, but if you only needed to go at 100 gigabits, you'd probably do only one stream. So, relatively feasible. So, okay, so now this ends up looking like you have a pipeline of input. So, from the network interface side, you end up having information, you know, like data flowing into our to receive pipeline that does some amount of this reconfigurable configuration, then potentially going off and doing some DMA, then potentially cycling around maybe multiple DMA operations or so forth. And then in some cases, possibly having a transmit pipeline. This one is essentially the application saying, hey, I have some work for you to do. You need to look at it and try to figure out what to do with it. And then some queue manager that runs on top of it. So assuming that you have this, then the idea would then be the fast path for TCP would be simple enough to put in the model, that this software version that we built is actually kind of directly what you'd be able to implement in hardware. We actually, in some ways, actually did it in the opposite order. We thought we needed hardware, so we designed a really simplified TCP to run on the hardware, because it needed to be simple to run on the hardware. And then we discovered that actually that simple TCP actually ran fast if you ran it on software, so that's a good thing too. And then essentially the NIC processing ends up doing all of the standard stuff that the TCP engine would need to do. So for example, app generation or information about collecting information about congestion control, but then the application of any policy intervention that's done in the kernel. And so at the end, like, this is the performance side of it. And say, okay, that then takes you some amount of performance better than this. So the yellow line is essentially the hardware side of emulated hardware for what would happen if we had hardware. Okay, and I'm now running out of time, so I'm gonna skip by the a model for how this would look is, if I started out with my application spending only a little bit of my time, then moving over to software gives you some substantial benefit, but then your application still might spend some portion of the time. But then eventually with hardware and software support, eventually you can get down to a certain level. One of the things that could possibly be an interesting thing that goes forward from this is that possibly some of the application specific data path could also potentially be moved down to hardware. But I'm going to skip all of that and kind of move to the end. Because I actually had one other thing that I wanted to say, so in addition to kind of a summary here, which is that our future systems, that I talked about Arrakis and then this notion that, hey, we can do a lot better job without having to necessarily compromise what protocols we're running in the network side. And then essentially you could do a similar kind of question for how do you build faster file systems. One of the implications of this, I will just talk through that. So one of the implications of this is that, like, we are all operating system developers now. Like, if you thought you were an application developer, the future world is going to have I/O devices mapped into your application that you're going to have to figure out how to manage. And so now you have concurrency is going to be just something that, like, all application developers are faster. You don't need to be doing anything that that's something that you're going to need to deal with. But also that we're all hardware designers. Increasingly, application code will be not just you write some feature and great, that's fine. But if it's something that's high performance or needs to be high performance, you need to figure out how you're going to map that onto some set of hardware and software implementation, potentially rolling specific VLSI for it eventually. So the last thing I wanted to talk about is kind of take the opportunity, given that it's a distinguished lecture, to give you a little bit of my personal background. And sorry, I didn't get that last little biography thing there. So I didn't actually start out as a computer scientist, and this is mostly for the benefit of the grad students in the audience. Appreciate your patience. Probably some of you don't really care that much about operating systems. You want to do machine learning, that's why you're in school. I should say, hardware design for machine learning is going to happen, you know, so being able to do, like, this is not, like, that far off of what you need to be able to do. But what you should understand about, like, how, like, you could think, oh, okay, people who are teaching you all look like they know what they're doing, and you're in grad school and you don't know what you're doing, you feel like you never know what you're doing. And I think it's, like, an opportunity for those of us who've been in academics for a long time, just to, like, remind you that we used to be grad students too, and we didn't know what we were doing when we were grad students. I started out not doing computer science. I was originally a math and physics person, and just discovered that actually I couldn't do math well enough to be able to hang with people who were really good at math, and I couldn't do physics well enough to hang with the people who could do really physics really well. So then I was like, okay, what else am I going to do with my life? I decided to do psychology. I was like, this terrified my mother, as you might imagine. And then fortunately, like, after a year or so of that, I was like, okay, this is really boring and I don't really like this. I learned a lot that was really helpful for raising kids. I was like, this is really helpful. But then, you know, my girlfriend at the time decided that she's actually a philosophy major, and she said, yeah, you know, oh, you really you hate the classes you're taking. Why don't you take some classes that are like mine? Yeah, maybe that would be good. Anyway, so I took the class on Kant. I really liked it. I should say, if you want to improve your writing, taking a philosophy class is a great way to do it. It helps logic. helps you try to understand how what people are trying to say with words, and that really helps. One of the reasons I think I ended up being a textbook writer is because of that. But it's like, okay, well, how do I get from philosophy off into computer science? Well, of course, philosophy, like, what are you going to do with a philosophy degree except drive a cab? So I started taking computer science classes. Again, my girlfriend at the time took computer science class, thought, oh, this is pretty good. My first computer science class, I kid you not, was operating systems, which is like scary. It was like I was a senior at that point. I had run out of time. I had to take something. I didn't know what the heck I was doing. I literally didn't understand the class at all until 5 years later. I took a compiler class, and quite literally my compiler compiled. And what I mean by that is it didn't crash. It syntax checked. When you ran it, it crashed immediately. So the fact that assignments don't get done on time, or that we don't, that isn't really the task, right? I ended up getting a pretty interesting job. I built an operating system as part of my job. That was really kind of cool. Went back to grad school. I got, by the way, turned down from every grad school I applied to except for one, and I only got into that one because the person I ended up working for knew the TA I was took a class from. It was like, oh, it was just luck. Grad school was great, but it was like this really humbling experience because clearly I didn't know anything about what I needed to do for being able to get to grad school. So what you see out of people who succeed over time in computer science tends to be one of these things of persistence, but also a certain level of putting yourself aside and not making judgments about whether you know something or not, or have to compare yourself to other people. And then just, do you enjoy the work or not? Do you think it's interesting? And then pursuing it because you think it's interesting and believing enough of yourself to stick with it long enough for you to get good at it. Anyway, so those are kind of life lessons. No one who's a good computer scientist has got there in a linear fashion. Everybody can go so far. So I guess we'll stop there.
Thank you. Any questions?
Yes.
So you mentioned implementing TCP as a system service. So if an app wants to use the service, it still incurs IPC costs, right?
Yes, actually, so the IPC cost is, you don't have to think of it as automated. You can think of it as no worse. With SRIV, there's no difference here between that and what would happen if it was done in a specialized kernel service that was designed for the purpose of doing high-performance communication with the application. So what I can do by doing as a user level is just get around the notion that you have to have a system call interface for it. So what you would like to be able to design that interface to be would be like hardware queues. Like that I already understand and the application sets up a per flow queue for me to put my data into. So as a consequence, the data just shows up for the application directly where it wants it. So you're doing IPC communication, but it's like essentially memory communication, memory to memory communication. The modern TCP engine would essentially try to run the kernel code that's doing all the TCP processing on the same processor as where the application is running, and that also gets in the way. And so by running as a service, you're actually running it on different cores than what the application is doing. The socket call is actually just happening in the user level library. So it looks like it's a socket call, so the application code doesn't have to change at all. But it's actually just reading that, like if it's doing a poll, if it's doing an e-poll, it's then turning that into, okay, was there a notification that I sent any packets into this into any of the queues that I'm looking for, and then you then just go ahead and leave from that queue.
Any other questions? Yes.
Yeah.
So before the question for the students, if you're waiting, the keyword for that announced is OS.
That's hard. That's how it is. I don't know whether you can remember that.
Capitalized.
Yeah, it's capitalized.
Yes.
Yeah. If you misspell that Oz, then
so you talked a little bit about making the TCP processing efficient through sort of a software-defined approach, but also using a little bit more of the hardware.
Yeah.
Now in the group communication world, there's been this concept, first, not everything needs to go through all the requirements that TCP has.
Sure.
And therefore, in the group communication world, for example, there's this concept of micro protocols where you're trying to compose different functionalities into that kind of communication stack. Do you envision something like that sort of folding into the operating system level?
So it's an interesting thing. The hiccup for group communication in the data center setting hasn't been very high. And I think it's a little hard to know why that's the case, but at least one of them is the notion that you do need to have some kind of resource management for the network itself. And so if you allow an application to be able to send to a large number of nodes with only a single operation, then there's information that needs to come back from the network as to whether that's allowed. Like, you have to have some kind of pushback from the network. Either you have to give that high priority, or it's using resources that the rest of the network needs to understand about. If that gets turned into individual, like, oh, I send this packet and then that packet and then that packet, then okay, and then you have to worry about what's going to happen if some of those connections are not as used. I think it's an interesting question, a really, really interesting question, how to do this co-design of the distributed systems, which are the cases that you're talking about, like if I want to do Paxos or want to do some kind of group operation, and network protocol, how do I manage the network packets and the endpoint. What I do think is true is that all of those parts of the systems are becoming more configurable. And now, like, can we use that to still solve the problems we have? So, resource allocation, fair, multi-tenant use. I think that's all really important. I think it's still somewhat unsolved. So I guess that's where I would go. Yeah.
Kind of as a follow-up to that, I recently learned that not enough switches these days implement NPI for network operations on the switch. And so it's essentially pushing kind of the group communication into the switch.
Yeah, so there's a really nice work, I don't know if you've seen it, by some colleagues at UW that looked at, say, implementing a sequencer in the in a network switch, which is not too hard to do, because you just send packets through and then it labels a packet with a sequence number that's adding to it. So if you have that, then certain group protocols become easier to build. So like that kind of thing, I think is potentially really interesting.
So where in your later designs did perfection fall? Was that in the operating system still, or did that get to the
hardware? So you can think of it by this analogy of virtual memory. So virtual memory is implemented on the hardware, but it's configured by the operating system. And so if the in our case, if the enforcement of congestion control, for example, it would be, the information would be collected in hardware and then enforced by, essentially, and the rate control would be enforced by hardware. But then the question would be, okay, how does the kernel get the information? The kernel needs to be able to say, this particular flow should only go a certain rate. So it's needing to get information from, kind of periodic information from the hardware about what, the typical example would be how many ECM packets were marked. So if flow has not had ECM packets, it means that there wasn't queuing, and so it's fine for it to send over rate. If there are ECM packets, then it needs to back off the rate. And so that enforcement of that is happening in hardware, and the setting of the rates is happening. So all of this actually includes the fact that the kernel is waking up periodically to do some of that work.
Yeah, so when you first mentioned implementing things on the NIC, it occurred to me that it's kind of scary putting protection in hardware given how many different guards there could be and how many people could screw it up along the way.
Yeah, no, I think absolutely. But part of the argument for configuration is to say that you would like to have these interfaces designed in a way that's actually stable, that's sustainable over time, like that will actually be able to allow you to adapt. Currently, one of the challenges that you have for deploying RDMA is that there's one algorithm for doing congestion control, and it has to, all the hardware has to be No, it's only a single vendor today. It's essentially, there's only one major RDMA vendor, so that's pretty easy for it to do. But if you got into a world where there had to be many of them, then they had to worry about interoperating and so forth. So that ends up being kind of a challenge for it.
So by protection, you mean, you don't mean things like access control?
Well, access control being an example. Like, you wanted to say, for example, you'd like to be able to have the hardware have the configuration property that if I want to say for a particular application that it is only allowed to talk to these 10 nodes. Like, I've set up a VLAN that says these 10 nodes can talk to each other at a container level. And it's not allowed to talk to anyone else. Or it's only allowed to talk to the services, other services in the system. Not able to talk to any other. That is like, it's a natural programming model for containers to have. And what you'd like is that configuration step to be done in software, but then the enforcement of it to be done in hardware. Because the other alternative is that you're tracking to the operating system and saying, oh, is this an allowed packet or not an allowed packet? But that's actually just a wild card check, so it's not necessarily all that hard to say, okay, this is just an enforcement program. So you would have some kind of configuration step.
TCP seems like an odd design choice for low latency transactions, right? And you probably want something like cache coherence, right? And maybe in a scale of a rack, it's actually feasible, right? Because we're kind of approaching the hardware limits of physical hardware limits, so wasting cycles and recomputing lost packets. And hardware seems to be reasonably reliable as well.
So within a rack, I could definitely see that you would do. Eventually you want to have a kind of more memory-based approach to it. I'm not necessarily taking a stand as to how you should do communication on the rack. In general, most of the distributed systems, like if you're doing large-scale, like, you know, the core element of Facebook is doing a web server that's then doing a large number of small RPCs to a large number of Memcache servers, and doing that as fast as you possibly can.
Right.
Now, it's actually using EDP because TCP is too slow, so, and it's ignoring the congestion stuff. But it's kind of like, oh, okay, we're going to engineer this in a different way. But that's kind of that's their basic mechanism, and how much Facebook costs or what Facebook's like operational cost is entirely in that. And is that interloop efficient today? No, it's nowhere close. So that's where they're going to go.
I kind of believe that there will be some co-design between network protocols.
Oh, well, no, I'm not.
Data center scale systems, I guess.
Yeah, so I guess partly, I guess I was pushing, trying to argue for this notion that the hardware design should be as configurable as possible so that you're not binding the decision as to what the protocol should be. What we ended up trying to do TCP because it was kind of this extreme case. Rather than thinking TCP is what you should do, it was that TCP at least is a proof of concept that it's all the features you currently have. So I'd like to be able to show that I could do everything you currently can do with the network and at the OS layer, that I can do that in some combination of OS and hardware that's efficient. And so that's where that's going, rather than thinking, okay, TCP is the answer. It's that any protocol that you would have that does some of this would have some of the features that TCP would have. And maybe you could get rid of some of the features to make it faster, but at some level, maybe they're all there for a reason.
All right, sounds good. That's a nice speaker.